State President of Narayanan, National Vice President Dr. Ananda Keshavan, Secretary General of Central IAP 2018-19 Dr. Ramesh, respected teachers, today's chair of the session, Sukumaran sir, today's speaker of the day, Dr. Sushil Kabra sir, respected teachers, colleagues and friends, today is the 8th session of Beyond Horizon Meet the Doyen series. Today's talk is by Dr. Sushil Kabra, Professor of Pediatrics, All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. He will talk on approach to recurrent respiratory tract infection in pediatrics in children. On behalf of IAP Kerala and IAP Kozhikode, a warm welcome to you, sir, to this Zoom meeting. Sushil Kabra, sir. I also welcome State President Dr. Narayanan, State Secretary Dr. Bala, National Vice President Dr. Ananda Keshavan, Chair of the session, Sukumaran sir. He is the past National President of IAP 2011 and retired from Government Medical College, Kottayam, as a Professor of Pediatrics, a great academician. Our State President, Dr. Narayanan, can ask me to convey his blessing to this meeting, and he's not talking to save the time. I invite Dr. Ananda Keshavan for inaugural remarks.
Good evening, everybody. Respected Chairperson Dr. Ashraf. Today's chairperson, past national president Dr. Subhan sir, state secretary Bala, branch secretary Dr. Naha, today's chief guest Sushil Kabra sir, Shishan sir, Parvati madam, and my dear friends. At the outset, I would like to congratulate IAP Kozhikode for bringing out very interesting topic by great persons, all of international speakers like Kabra sir. And as such, we know that the respiratory tract infection is always a commonest condition in pediatric purpose. But when it is a recurrent, it's always treatment may not be a problem, but recurrent diagnosis is very difficult. Sometimes we have to use so many other newer modality of test also. I think today's CME will be highlight all these aspects. I wish the CME all the success, all the best. Thanking you. Jai Hind, Jai AP.
Now I invite Dr. Ramesh, who is the coordinator of scientific committee of this program, for opening remarks.
Respected Chair of the Day, President of IAP Kozhikode, Dr. Ashraf, Vice President of South Zone, Central IAP, as well as our great friend, Dr. Ananda Keshavan, my teacher, as well as mentor in IAP, Dr. T.U. Sukumaran, sir, Chief Guest of the Day, Dr. Kabra, Dr. Narayan, our State President, is not here, Dr. Balachandran, Secretary Kozhikode, Dr. Nihas, and the scientific person from Kozhikode, Dr. Vijay Kumar, scientific convener, and Dr. Sachi sir and Parvati ma'am and all seniors on the platform, as well as my friends across in IAP. Good evening and welcome to another great session in store for us here today. The Doyens of Pediatrics is going into the 8th edition today, and we have got a great renowned expert in pulmonology to cater to our growing appetite for learn and learn about respiratory infections. However much you hear about respiratory infections, it is still a recurrent disease, as is the respiratory infections are. Of course, of late for the last 3 months or 5 months, it's just right up respiratory infections. This topic itself is, I don't know how we are not coming up, but it's good to see that our children are not suffering. But all said and done, the bottom line is we are going to face respiratory infections time and again, and we should be well equipped. And whatever tip, learning experience you can get from any renowned expert anywhere, especially our seniors, Sukumaran sir, as well as Kabra sir, who are here, our years and years of mine of wealth, mine of knowledge in respiratory medicine. They are here to sensitize us and keep us updated about those issues. And I welcome both of them on behalf of IAP Kerala and IAP Kozhikode. And I wish a very great scientific feast here today for all of us who are gathered here. Thank you very much, IAP Kozhikode and IAP Kerala, and IAP Jai Hind. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ramesh. Today's session is Approach to Recurrent Respiratory Tract Infection in Pediatrics. And today's speaker is Dr. Sushil Kabra. And the session is chaired by Dr. Sukumaran sir, past National President of Central IAP, as well as the past National President of Respiratory Chapter. And he is also interested in the respiratory area. Over to you, sir, Sukumaran sir.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, sir.
Okay. Thank you. And let me at the outset thank Dr. Ashraf and Dr. Naha for inviting me and giving this opportunity to chair this session. And also my hearty congratulations to IAP Calicut for organizing a number of webinars with international speakers on the forum. And today we are lucky to have Dr. S.K. Kabra with us, and he will be talking on recurrent respiratory infections in childhood. As Dr. Ramesh has pointed out, as you all know, COVID-19 is a pandemic going on throughout the world. And lockout following COVID-19 has produced few positive impact and few negative impact. This produces a positive impact on child health. The main positive impact is the incidence of respiratory infection has come down. Our air pollution has come down. The quality of air quality index in most of the cities has improved. And this has led to decreased incidence of respiratory infection, decreased incidence of viral respiratory illnesses, decreased incidence of asthma, and asthma relapse is not seen now. So all our asthmatics are controlled now. This is mainly because of the SMS, the effect of SMS, social distancing, mask, and sanitizer. So I think even after the COVID is over, we should continue with this SMS so that our children are free from frequent respiratory infections and allergic disorders like asthma. As you all know, respiratory infection, especially recurrent respiratory infection, is a common problem in pediatric practice. And it is seen that all children can have up to 6 to 10 upper respiratory infection per year. As a child goes around 2 to 3 years, as the child goes to kindergarten or nursery, they develop recurrent respiratory infection, what is known as the nursery school syndrome. And there are multiple causes of recurrent respiratory infection in children, starting from asthma, tuberculosis, congenital malformation, congenital heart disease, aspiration syndromes like GERD, foreign body, neurological problem, cystic fibrosis, primary ciliary dyskinesia, immunodeficiency. It goes on like this. There's a long list is there. And we are fortunate to have Dr. Kabra with us, who is a close friend of mine, who is a professor of pediatric pulmonology from Old Institute of Medical Science, Delhi. He is the editor-in-chief of Indian Journal of Pediatrics. And his main research areas are, as you know, he's a pioneer in cystic fibrosis, bronchial asthma, tuberculosis, and acute respiratory infection. He's the main person behind our asthma training module and Asthma by Consensus, which was published years back. And he has more than 545 publications to his credit, and he has written 175 chapters in different books. And his main books are Essentials of Pediatrics Pulmonology and Essentials of TB in Children, and the PICU Protocol, Old Institute, AMS Protocol, PICU Protocol. With these words, with great pleasure and privilege, I invite Dr. Kabra to start his talk on Approach to Recurrent Respiratory Infections in Pediatrics. Dr. Kabra, please.
Okay, respected chairpersons and friends, I am very thankful to IAP, Kozhikode, and Kerala for giving me opportunity to interact with friends who are thousands of miles away from Delhi. And I think it would be a new normal over next few months, not for few years, I believe that we may have to go like this, or it will be a mix with some people are in a physical attendance and majority are doing this type of interaction. So I hope you are able to see my slides.
Yes, okay, right.
And my voice, I am audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
So we'll start with this thing that what should be approach to a recurrent respiratory tract infection in pediatrics. And outline of my presentation is, what is the magnitude of problem? Upper and lower airway infection. What is recurrent? Mimickers of acute respiratory infection. When to worry about recurrent ARI and investigate them, and when you call it is a recurrent pneumonia. And then I'll be discussing some representative cases, and then lastly, approach to a child. So ARI accounts for 20 to 40% of OPD and 12 to 30% of IPD patients. And majority of them, up to 90%, are upper respiratory tract infection and caused by viruses. Frequency of viral URTI is, as Dr. Sukumaran suggested, 6 to 10. It is 3 to 10 episodes per child per year in younger infants and children below 5 years of age. And we have a data from our AIMS birth cohort study published a few years ago. It was in 2017, in which we followed 300 children, newborn, for seeing what is the impact of ARI on their pulmonary function test. And we documented that it is a 1.8 episodes per infant per year, and 95% were viral upper respiratory tract infection. So it suggests that ARI occurs in every infant, in some more frequently. Majority recover without much intervention. But what is recurrent and when to investigate is the question which we face in our day-to-day clinical practice. So what is recurrent? For upper respiratory tract infection, as we had seen, it may be each child may have 5 to 10 episodes, and in our cohort, it was at least 2 episodes per child per year. Suggests that it is not uncommon to have a recurrent upper respiratory infection. The cutoff that when we will say that it is recurrent is not known. But some children who have some other respiratory problem may have a more often these upper respiratory tract infections. For lower respiratory tract infection, because it is a serious issue, recurrent pneumonia is defined as 2 episodes of clinical features with documented radiological pneumonia with clearing in between over 1 year or 3 episodes over any time frame. And there is a similar clinical condition, that is persistent pneumonia, in which there is an unremitting symptom with persistent radiological abnormality over 1 month, then you say it is a persistent pneumonia. It is important to know these 2 definitions because that will decide when to investigate these patients. So now the concern is, since upper respiratory tract infection is very common, when we should investigate for cause of these infections. So these are the common indications, like if there are extra respiratory symptoms, specifically say someone is having a gastrointestinal symptom, someone is having a repeated otitis media, though it is upper respiratory, but there are extra pulmonary symptoms or extra respiratory symptoms. If there is a failure to thrive, that suggests that whatever may be the cause of upper respiratory tract infection, it definitely needs to be investigated. If there are marked chronic upper airway symptoms, like if a child is having a snoring, rhinitis, sinusitis, if these are there, these suggest that child needs, these are not something common upper respiratory viral infection, there is a need for some other investigation and treatment. And this group will include, majority of these patients would be having an adenoidal hypertrophy. Symptoms from the first day of life, unusual, that the child developed symptoms from the first day itself. It suggests that we should rule out some conditions like primary ciliary dyskinesia or cystic fibrosis. If episodes are severe, persistent, unusual pathogens, or recurrent, in those situations, this suggests that there may be some underlying primary or secondary immune deficiency, and we need to investigate. If there is a chronic moist or wet cough sputum production, that also suggests that we need to investigate these patients. If there is a feeding problem, as we will be seeing, that feeding problem is one of the major cause of repeated respiratory lower respiratory tract infection. So a good history regarding feeding is very important. If there are continuous under-meeting or worsening symptoms with waxing and waning pores, these needs to be investigated even if it is a upper respiratory viral. It is considered to be upper respiratory viral infection. Before we decide that yes, this patient requires investigation, we should rule out, identify mimickers. And these are recurrent allergic rhinitis. And we can easily identify by a positive family history of allergy. Examination of the child may show a nasal mucosal edema, hyperemia of the mucosa, clear nasal discharge, post-nasal drip, poor cobalt stone appearance of the pharynx, and response to antihistamines, absence of fever in most of the conditions, and other allergic diathesis in form of associated asthma, allergic conjunctivitis, and others. And of course, the atypical allergic rhinitis, which is chronic, then there may be other clinical features, say those rhinitis, salam, and other things. Also, they can easily be identified. Then other is recurrent viral infection associated wheezing that may mimic pneumonia because there may be sometimes fever, tachypnea, wheezing, breathlessness, and X-ray may be normal in these patients. If they are getting very repeated episodes of wheezing, then and with or without other allergic response to bronchodilator, allergy and response to bronchodilator. And we are aware that it may be episodic wheezing, it may be multi-trigger wheeze. And if a patient is, even if someone is getting a repeated, because generally we do not suggest that we should be getting X-ray film of the chest in, if it is episodic wheezing or multi-trigger wheeze, but if any of those these findings are there, then you will go for X-ray, and then if X-ray is normal and repeated wheezing, then you will say that these are probably, we are dealing with a viral infection associated wheezing, Valery, or infant wheezing. So first, let us see what are the causes of recurrent URTI. Apart from a recurrent common cold or rhinitis, what are the other causes? So other cause which come in a clinical practice very often is recurrent pharyngotonsillitis. It is common during 4 to 8 years of age because during that time, our lymphatic system is hypertrophied. There is no underlying cause in majority, and they recover with antibiotic and symptomatic treatment. Tonsillectomy should be considered if a patient is, we have diagnosed it as a recurrent pharyngotonsillitis, then, and which is not responding and it is very frequent, causing any of those failure to thrive and other extrapulmonary symptoms in form of sinusitis or otitis. In those situations, we may consider tonsillectomy, but it is required. The definition for indication of tonsillectomy would be 7 or more documented episodes in the preceding year, 5 or more in each of the 2 preceding years, 3 or more in each in preceding 3 years, or if it is producing obstructive sleep apnea. These are the indications for doing the tonsillectomy. So many children may be coming to you who have been suggested by our ENT colleague that go for a tonsillectomy. So if the patient is having any of these, we can suggest, otherwise between 4 to 8, we should wait. Recurrent sinusitis, we need to see local cause like obstruction, some polyposis, deviated nasal septum, and of course, if these are not there, and if it is a frequent, then we may have to think of primary ciliary dyskinesia, cystic fibrosis, primary immune deficiency. And sometimes, if there is a otitis media with or without effusion, we have to think of adenoidal hypertrophy, primary ciliary dyskinesia, PID, and so on. So we'll be discussing some of these, what should be our approach. Then we come to lower respiratory tract infection. And one of them is croup, recurrent croup. So generally we say that as a general discussion is that infections are uncommon cause for production for presenting as a recurrent croup. If someone is presenting with a recurrent croup in form of a harsh brassy cough along with stridor, in that case, think of alternative diagnosis rather than giving the treatment for recurrent laryngotracheal bronchitis. So the other causes include congenital structural abnormality in form of a web, subglottic hemangioma, foreign body, subglottic stenosis secondary to previous intubation, respiratory papillomatosis and recurrent aspirations. These are causes which we need to consider if someone is presenting with recurrent croup. And these children should be investigated apart from we should go directly for a laryngoscopy, bronchoscopy, and studies for recurrent aspiration. And sometimes they may need a imaging in form of a MRI or CT angio. Now we come to recurrent lower respiratory tract infection, common is pneumonia. And though these data are very old, almost two decades ago, these were the causes of recurrent pneumonia when we analyzed RTCs at AIMS. And recurrent aspiration, as you can see, 1/4 of the patients had the recurrent aspiration, and which may be because of reflux, esophageal stricture, or it may be post-op tracheoesophageal fistula, S-type tracheal fistula, pharyngeal incoordination, vascular ring, all these things. So if a patient is getting repeated pneumonia as and fulfills the case definition, in those situations, we should think of various causes of aspirations. Then structural abnormality like partial agenesis of lobe, diaphragmatic hernia, eventration, kyphoscoliosis, all these may be responsible for repeated respiratory infection. As you can see, these were 15% at that time, two decades ago, now more. And because now we are able to identify more and more patients with immune deficiency. Others are post-tubercular bronchiectasis, very poorly controlled asthma, ciliary dyskinesia. Now, if you do ciliary dyskinesia workup, you may find more cases, retained foreign body, chronic lung disease. And at that time, we could not identify cause in 16%. But as I said, these are two decades ago. And now there will be more of a primary immune deficiency, ciliary dyskinesia, and cystic fibrosis. In this analysis, we had ruled out, we did not include children with cystic fibrosis. So another condition is persistent pneumonia. You can see, again, recurrent aspiration, bronchiectasis, immune deficiency, and other causes were identified in our series. So now we go on to some representative cases, which may help, though these may be rarer cases. A general pediatrician or pediatrician may not see these patients, but these will help us in having our approach to a patient. So this 3-month-old girl presented with persistent respiratory difficulties since birth. Hospitalized thrice for exacerbations, worsening of symptoms for last 3 days currently, and there is no family history of asthma allergy. And X-ray, you can see here, this is the X-ray in which there is a hyperinflation of the left upper lobe with collapse of the left lower lobe, and mediastinum is shifted towards the opposite side, towards the right side. So it is a persistent respiratory difficulty, recurrent worsening due to aspiration infection. And a condition is called CPAM, congenital lobar emphysema of the left upper lobe. So, and you can see the CT scan. Again, it suggests that there is a hyperinflation of the left upper lobe. And if you see, sometimes you may say that why it is not a collapse of the right lower lobe. Then you have to differentiate by seeing the vascular markings. You can see there is a rarity or paucity of the vascular markings here as compared to the right side. So that's why we should be deciding about which is the disease site. So here, wherever there is a decrease in the vascularity, you will say that that is a disease part. Or now we confirm that it is unlikely to be a collapse or atelectasis of the right side. So a good history, like age of onset in this child, it is 3 months. Feeding difficulty, persistent tachypnea, in between exacerbations, careful reading of the X-ray gives the clue. You confirm the diagnosis by doing a CT scan, and the treatment is removal of the left upper lobe, which is symptomatic. Now you can see here that this 18-month-old boy has a recurrent pneumonia, difficulty and choking since early infancy, failure to thrive, and you can see here and required hospitalization. You can see here that this is a barium swallow in which this is the esophagus, this is going into a trachea, and this is a S-type tracheal fistula. So though it is an 18-month-old child, but you are able to see you are able to see a S-type precursor fistula. And so in this patient, diagnosis of aspiration secondary to S-type precursor fistula. So again, a history that a patient is getting choking while feeding, vomiting, feeding difficulty since early infancy. Contrast studies may give diagnosis for gastroesophageal reflux and S-type precursor fistula. So this way, history is very important and contrast studies may help in some patients. So you can see another patient. This 10-month-old boy with Down syndrome with recurrent pneumonia and feeding difficulty. And because of feeding difficulty, you get a barium swallow. And you can see there is a impression over here suggesting that it is a aberrant left subclavian artery going towards the right side and compressing the esophagus, causing repeated aspirations. And so this case suggests that correlation of associated malformation and clinical symptoms may help in deciding about the investigation to confirm the diagnosis. In Down syndrome, if there is a feeding difficulty, you will think of aberrant vessel or gross gastroesophageal reflux. I'll be able to answer these questions at the end. Okay. So this again, this is a 2.5-year-old boy with dysphagia and recurrent pneumonia. Dysphagia again there. So as you are seeing, all these three patients are having difficulty in feeding. So it is very important if a patient is getting repeated pneumonia and you have to take a detailed history about the feeding history, whether there is any problem. So you can see here that this is abnormal X-ray. There are infiltrates here and there along with this. So generally in clinical practice, you can say that this is a hilar lymph node and it may be tuberculosis. But we should be very careful for giving a diagnosis of tuberculosis if patient is having a repeated problem. The first thing, if a patient is having an unremitting fever and cough for more than 2 weeks, you'll think of TB. But if someone is recovering and then again having the problem, and if there is a dysphagia, think of some alternative diagnosis rather than tuberculosis. So when you get a lateral X-ray, you can see there is a large mass which is near the airway and which is compressing the airway as well as possibly esophagus and which is causing repeated aspiration pneumonia. And in that situation, if you get a there is a deviation suggesting that there is some soft tissue, and if you do a CT scan, there is a subcarinal large cystic lesion. And that is suggestive of bronchogenic cyst if it is near the airways in subcarinal region. So this patient got operated, and you can see that after operation, these shadows have improved. These have disappeared, and this was a bronchogenic cyst. So history of aspiration, X-ray showing some mass lesion, CT may help. In this situation, possibly we could have avoided barium. But we did both, and then CT scan helped, and then our pediatric surgeon colleague removed the bronchogenic cyst, and child is now okay. So if you see this 10-year-old child, persistent cough, along with wheezing and intermittent exacerbations, received 3 courses of anti-TB drug, but there was no response to, because of wheezing, bronchodilators also, but he was not responding to bronchodilators. And because of this, you had seen that in previous case, we could identify that there is some mass lesion, and same thing here, there is a large superior mediastinal widening. And so lateral X-ray, it suggests that this is the anteriorly pushed trachea. And there is something over here which is pushing trachea anteriorly, which may be because of some mass lesion, because of esophagus, maybe because of lymph nodes. And then if you see the CT scan, this is a hugely dilated esophagus with air fluid level. You can see here, and then you can see some ground glass edginess because of repeated aspirations. And this is the barium swallow, which is typical of red tail appearance, a usually dilated esophagus with a red tail-like structure of the terminal end, suggesting that it is a esophageal stricture, or you can say ecclesia cardia, which is congenital. And again here, this patient had come to us for drug-resistant tuberculosis, but when we took a history and then we found that the child is aspirating, it is not unremitting cough, and mother could give that sometimes there is a food particles which comes out of the mouth and nose when he is sleeping, he gets asleep. So we were very clear that we are dealing with something with the esophagus. And when there was no response to bronchodilator, when there is no response to ATT as per the expectation, it is worth going for further investigation. This 6-month-old child with recurrent pneumonia, drooping of the right left shoulder, and X-ray showing significant loss of lung volume on the left side. And since it is 6-month-old, onset of illness was from the neonatal period, then we thought of whether it is either it may be a muscle collapse, agenesis, hypoplasia, or it may be muscle atelectasis. So such a patient may directly, we can go for either, if you have a possibility of doing a bronchoscopy to identify whether there is a this thing, left main bronchus is agenated, or whether there is a hypoplasia. If that is not possible, you can go for a CT scan to see whether the both the bronchi are patent and whether there is a left pulmonary artery absent. So agenesis of the left pulmonary artery and absence of left main bronchus suggests that we are dealing with agenesis of the left lung. So as you can see, if you have this X-ray, this history, you can directly go for a bronchoscopy if that is feasible. If that is not feasible, you can go for a CCT to document whether there is a agenesis of the left pulmonary artery, and you can make a diagnosis. You can see here, right lung is hyperinflated, there is overcrowding of the ribs, and right lung is herniating towards the other side in complete shift of the mediastinum. This 3-month-old boy, cough, fever, and difficulty in breathing, past history of pneumonia 3 times till now, consanguinity, SIP death due to similar illness, examination, respiratory rate, you can just see that 3-month-old child, 100 per minute, heart rate 160 per minute, length is 52, suggesting that he is not growing well, with a rhizomelic shortening, and weight is just 3 kilo. With consanguinity, sibling death, bilateral crepitations, no wheezing or bronchial back sound. Oxygen saturation in room air was 92% with such a large, significant respiratory difficulty. And on oxygen, it was improving to 92, otherwise it was around 60. And you can see X-ray. This is the typical X-ray, which is suggestive of bell-shaped X-ray with small ribs. Anterior ends of the ribs are not coming anteriorly. They are just sort of lateral side. They are stopping there. These are bulbous anterior ends. This is asphyxiating thoracic dystrophy. You can just see the child, see that it is short. There is a disproportionate short stature. Along with that, you see this X-ray, this short diagnosis. So taking consideration when a patient is having SIP death, consanguinity, musculoskeletal abnormality, ribcage abnormality, then myopathy. These are the various conditions which may be identified. This 10-month-old child admitted twice for pneumonia, oral thrush and diarrhea with Kohn's sepsis, the coagulase negative staphylococcus sepsis. And because of this oral thrush, Kohn's sepsis and recurrent diarrhea and pneumonia, he was investigated for primary immune deficiency because his HIV was negative. That's why he was investigated. Immunoglobulins were normal for his age. CD4, CD8 counts were within normal limit. Nitroglutetrazoleum test, which is a screening method for screening chronic granulomatous disease. And if 90% of above of these cells are positive for nitroglutetrazoleum, then it is normal. And if it is between 50 to 90%, then we say it is a CGD carrier. And less than 50% is a CGD. So in this patient, it was 20%. And then later on, we confirm it with the dihydrorhodamine test. And so this is a chronic granulomatous disease. And you can say that how we could consider chronic granulomatous disease in such a patient. One is he's getting repeated multi-site infections, unusual organism in a 10-month-old child, Kohn's positive sepsis, along with oral thrush. And you can see the X-ray. There is a necrotizing pneumonia. There are large cystic lesions, necrosis, and multiple cystic lesions. In CT, you can see the multiple cystic lesions causing this necrotizing pneumonia due to staphylococcus. That suggests that either I'm dealing with, if someone is having this type of X-ray and repeated infection, either it may be a hyper IgE syndrome, CGD, or severe combined immune deficiency. But commonly it would be CGD and hyper IgE syndrome. So we should be considering. So these are the clues which we get it from these things, multi-site infections with necrotizing pneumonia. So you can see that primary immune deficiency disorders are emerging causes of recurrent infection. And you can see that if it is very severe infection, persistent, recurrent, unusual course, unusual pathogen, then you can identify, these will give you some clue. And these are some of the immune deficiency which can be identified or which may, you may get a clue from their physical examination. Say these brownish hair with hypopigmented skin, it may be Griscelli, or sometimes it may be confused with Chediak Higashi. Biscott Ehlrich, if there is these skin lesions along with thrombocytopenia, you can think of Biscott Ehlrich syndrome. This is, you can see this child having a this telangiectasia, and he had a sinopulmonary infection with diarrhea. And this is a child with severe combined immune deficiency who received BCG, and then there is a disseminated BCG disease. So these are two relatively rare conditions, but now with availability of investigations, we are able to identify. So we should be keeping a high index of suspicion if someone is having a severe infection, persistent infection, unusual pathogen, or recurrent. Think of primary immune deficiency. This 8-year-old girl presented with cough, recurrent breathlessness since age of 2 years. And she recovers with antibiotics. And if you see the X-ray, this X-ray was seen by multiple people, passed as having a hyperinflation on bilateral side. But they missed this, this area in which there is a retrocardiac sarc line, suggesting that there is a left lower lobe collapse. And when we did a CT scan of this, there was a bronchiectasis which was getting repeatedly infected, and whenever you give antibiotic, they were improving. So these are called, when you, whenever you are seeing an X-ray of a child with a recurrent respiratory problem, think of these, seeing these hidden area. Hidden area, one is these apexes and other one is retrocardium. So before labeling it as a normal X-ray, even when the child is having a recurrent respiratory problem, see these hidden area. Then this 18-month-old boy from Mumbai came for breathlessness and waxing and waning course of cough, fever, breathlessness. Diagnosed as pneumonia, treated with multiple antibiotics, and he is having marked respiratory difficulty as indicated by high respiratory rate, suprasternal, subcostal retractions. He is hypoxic in room air, but improving with this thing, 99% on oxygen by face mask. Chest bilateral crepitations and wheeze. There is no improvement with multiple medication. That's why he came to us. And X-ray showed, you can see here, that there is a hyperinflation. You can see flattening of the dome of diaphragm with, you can see more than 8 or 9 posterior ends of the ribs. Along with that, there are some peribronchial thickening bilateral lungs. And so a diagnosis of pneumonia, which is unresponsive to treatment. So various investigations were done, including sweat chloride, which was normal. Delta 5-8 mutation, he was already carrying with him. That was negative. Gastric aspirate for TB workup was negative. Gastroesophageal reflux scan was negative. HIV was non-reactive. Bronchoscopy was normal. Bronchial lavage suggested metapneumovirus, human metapneumovirus. And total IgE was slightly on the higher side. So these are the investigations which you generally do after getting the clue. And if you see the CT scan of this child, these are mediastinal window because these are known contrast enhanced. There is no significant abnormality, but these HRCT cuts, you can see some areas like these are black, some areas are white, suggesting that it is a small airway disease. If a child who is having a wheezing, persistent respiratory infection after a acute bronchiolitis kind of picture, you will think of that it may be a post-infectious bronchiolitis obliterans. So it was bronchiolitis obliterans, and you have a evidence, and you can make a diagnosis by seeing the clinical features, there is some airway obstruction, and the patient has not recovered from typical bronchiolitis for 6 weeks. Think of bronchiolitis obliterans, go for an investigation, and one of the investigation are CT scan that may give a very classical picture. If even after that, if it is not clear, then you can go for a biopsy. And this child was treated with supportive care. There was some improvement. Child is still coming in for follow-up. So post-viral sequelae in form of a bronchiolitis obliterans is being increasingly recognized, because earlier we would say that it may be PCD, it may be cystic fibrosis, but now when you are having an investigation, you can rule out other common causes, and then you may be recognizing more of a post-viral bronchiolitis obliterans. And now it is available. Earlier, we were not having access to getting these various viruses identified. You may be aware that this coronavirus infection, which is very common, say 15 to 20% of our patients may be having a upper respiratory viral infection because of the corona, but this typical COVID-19 is a recent thing. But it was not described in our reports, including our reports or our papers. This corona was not described because earlier we were not having the sophisticated these investigations for viral identification. Now with real-time multiplex PCR, we are able to identify many. With a single sample, we may be able to identify 24, sometimes 30 species of viruses. Okay, so this is a 14-month-old girl from Delhi, recurrent cough, wheeze, age of 2 months, chest reduced blood sound on the right side, not gaining weight, and history of rectal prolapse. There is a consanguinity, but no sibling death. There is a collapse consolidation of the right lower lobe. Gastroesophageal reflex showed a mild reflux. TB workup was negative. Started on antibiotic. No improvement for 2 weeks. And then we performed, because of this unresponsive, we performed bronchoscopy. And you can see that bronchoscope is in the trachea, now going towards the right main bronchus. This is the right upper lobe bronchus. And you can see thick viscid secretions are there. And that gave a clue that if there is a child who is having a wheezing, which is not responding, such a thick viscid secretions in the bronchoscopy, and there is a rectal prolapse. Think of cystic fibrosis, sweat chloride was done, that was high. So a child with persistent cough, collapse, pseudomonas from the airway, rectal prolapse, it may be cystic fibrosis. So this 10-month-old boy presented with history of respiratory distress since birth, diagnosed as transient tachypnea of newborn. Wet cough is persisting since age of 1 month, nasal discharge and ear problem. One episode of hemoptysis recently, consanguinity is positive, examination there is a clubbing, and a mild pH. Received multiple antibiotics and has such anti-TB drugs also. And you can see that the X-ray again showing us hidden area collapse. This is showing a bronchiectasis. There is a bronchiectasis, and CT angio because of hemoptysis, we saw that there is a dilated bronchial artery from which the hemoptysis was there. So we thought of PCD, and for a screening test for PCD is nasal NO, which will be low. In asthma, there is an increase in the FENO, while nasal NO is reduced in PCD and sometimes even in CF. We did a nasal brush high-speed video microscopy. I'll show you the result in the next slide. And we took an EM. And you can see this is distorted cilia. So diagnosis of PCD was made. And you can see this is the when we take a nasal brush and then we see it under microscope. These are the normal movements of cilia. And this is this patient's where you can see cilia at the breast border, but they are not moving at all. So this is a point of care test, you may make a diagnosis that it is a clear dyskinesia. This last patient is 8-month-old boy from Allahabad, presented with acute onset cough, fever, and respiratory distress 2 months ago while child was fed dal forcefully. Hospitalized and treated with oxygen, IV medication, IV fluid, and nebulization. Fever resolved in 5 days, but cough and respiratory distress persisted. And in view of persistent symptoms, someone started on anti-TB drug. He was obviously in respiratory difficulty. there was increase in the total leukocyte count, which was predominantly polymorphonuclear response and bilateral parahilar consolidation. You can see there is a dense consolidation, right, more than the left side. So we thought that it is a persistent pneumonia with recurrent respiratory symptoms. And then CT scan again confirmed that there is a dense consolidation. Patchy areas of consolidation seen in bilateral, parahilar, and right lower zone. And then we investigated for other causes, including blood culture, procalcitonin, CRP, bronchoscopy, bronchial lavage for TB, culture sensitivity for TB, barium swallow, GER, tutelizy, and sphectoride, all were within normal limit. In view of sudden onset of illness following a forced feeding of dal, blood for anti-lentil IgG, it was very high. It should be less than 1, but it was 170 milligram in this child. And anti-IgE was within normal limit. So we thought, we made a diagnosis of hypersensitivity pneumonitis, lentil aspiration. We started him on oral prednisolone 2 weeks. And after 2 weeks, you can see this is the beginning. And this is after 2 weeks, you can see there is a significant clearance. And he showed an improvement. And this is our group was working on it for last 8-7 years. We developed this anti-lentil and IgG antibodies, and then we thought that it is probably a new illness which may be more common in our country, which may be misdiagnosed as tuberculosis or other conditions, and we should be aware. And why I have included this case specifically to make our pediatrician colleagues aware that this is very common. Dal ka pani pilana, and it is forceful, is very common. And some children may develop this type of illness. We are working on it, that why there are only some children are getting this problem while others are not getting, while this practice of giving a forced feeding is not uncommon in our community. So we should be aware about it. And it was published last year. So hypersensitivity to aspirated food contents, lentil, dal, important cause for respiratory problem. And if pneumonia is unresponsive to standard treatment, think of non-infectious causes. So to summarize, multiple upper respiratory tract infection during infancy and childhood common, does not need investigations, but we should get alert if it is a severe, persistent, unusual organism, recurrent, failure to thrive, persistent upper airway problem. If none of these are present, follow up for weight gain and development of new signs and symptoms. If there is, take a good history of feeding problems, as you had seen in most patients, there was, it gave a clue, history of the chest findings, extrapulmonary manifestation, check X-ray carefully, or aspiration, may do a swallowing dysfunction study, or multiple infection, primary immune deficiency workup, for associated malabsorption, think of CF and do a workup, and persistent weight off with rhinosinusitis, think of primary ciliary dyskinesia. So this is the algorithmic approach. If there is a recurrent or persistent pneumonia, as I said, think of whether it fulfills the case definition. Take a history examination, do X-ray, rule out TB. And if you are getting a clue that there is a difficulty in feeding, choking during feed, think of getting an investigation in form of a swallowing difficulty, video assisted swallowing studies, gastroesophageal reflux, pH monitoring, etc. If infection in the other parts of the body, severe, persistent, recurrent, think of immune deficiency and investigate them with appropriate investigation. If associated malabsorption, pseudomonas in airway, think of CF, do sweat chloride or mutation studies. If no clues are there, then as we had seen, these are the investigation, bronchoscopy, CT, chest, GR studies, sweat test, and workup for primary immune deficiency. So this is all about this approach to a respiratory infection. Now it is open. If you have any queries, please let me know. I'll be more than willing to answer. I'll just see if there are queries.
Thank you, Dr. Kabra, for excellent presentations. I think there were some questions in the chat box. You can just see the chat box and answer the questions.
Suman sir, whether we read that question for you?
Yeah, you could just read the questions. So it'll be easy.
Yeah.
Ashraf, sir, Dr. Ashraf will read the questions.
Yes, Dr. Kabra, yes. Dr. Yeah, I
will read, sir.
Okay.
Sir, duration of systemic steroids and azithromycin for BOOP.
Or?
Boop, boop.
What is BOOP?
Okay, these are bronchiolitis obliterans.
Yeah, obliterans.
Post-infectious bronchiolitis obliterans.
Duration of systemic steroids.
We have recognized this condition more frequently now with availability of these adenovirus, PCR and CT scan and bronchoscopy and in some cases pulmonary function test. So there is no defined protocol for management, but many patients respond to steroids and there is no limit that till when we will be giving steroids. So what happens is initially you will give them systemic steroids to control the symptoms. You will gradually taper it, monitor oxygenation and respiratory difficulty, and we'll try to make it alternate day. And our protocol is that we give between 3 to 6 months and we replace it with the inhaled steroids. If they are not responding, then even we give bronchodilator along with ipratropium and sometimes even an off-label use of tritropium. And sometimes if they are responsive to steroids and once you taper the steroids, in that case, we give them a pulse methylprednisolone and then tritropium. So as I said, there is no set protocol, there is no set limit. You can decide based on the clinical judgment, response, and you will continue to give them alternate minimal doses till you want to keep them in remission.
Sir, another question is, will we include asthma as an etiology of recurrent pneumonia?
As I said, badly managed asthma, in which there may be some decreased or reduced airway clearance. Nowadays, it is difficult to see, but thanks to Dr. Sukumaran and all our senior pulmonary person, we have made all of our colleagues aware about the asthma, so we start the treatment. But if it is badly managed, there may be some atelectasis, there is some infection, and a minor repeated infection due to bronchitis. But otherwise, as such, you will not include asthma. Asthma should be ruled out before we say that it is a recurrent pneumonia.
Sir, what is the incidence of cystic fibrosis?
Yeah, it is, as of now, we cannot say with certainty that what is the incidence of CF in India. It may be because all our studies or all our quotations or citations are based on one study only, which was done for the identification of Delta 548 carrier state in Delhi. Around 1,000 these cord bloods were taken. And in that, we found that it may be 1 in 40,000, but it is an indirect evidence. Some patients who were migrated to UK, it has from our subcontinent, it was 1 in 10,000. So it may be somewhere between 1 in 10,000 to 1 in 40,000, but we may not be very certain. We need to do more studies.
Sir, next question is, what is the threshold of doing bronchoscopy? At what point we should go ahead with it instead of waiting for response to medications?
Yes, there are certain indications that bronchoscopy is an investigation which will give you a point of care test. Immediately, you may be able to identify airway problems. So if a patient is having a wheezing, stridor, and hyperinflation, then we should not be waiting. We do the bronchoscopy if the facility exists, if facility is there. Otherwise, as I said, if all other investigations are not there, they are negative, then you can go for some time CT scan. And if that is also not giving clue, then you may transfer the patient where this bronchoscopy is available. But if there is a possibility of airway problem, Malaysia's wheezing, some airway obstruction, foreign body, all these things, bronchoscopy should be the first investigation. And we would suggest that more and more people should learn this bronchoscopy.
Sir, should
okay,
we consider ABPA in a child presenting with recurrent infection?
Yes, if someone is behaving like an asthma, and then suddenly we find that his control has decreased or worsened. In those situations, if we find that there is some eosinophilia, there is repeated infection, there is some clubbing, there is a wet cough, think of ABPA. And which is not uncommon in a child who is uncontrolled asthma. In our studies, it is around 11 to 12% of our patients may have uncontrolled ABPA. And there is a set guideline that either it is a case of CF or asthma, there is an increased IgE, total Ig is more than 1000, specific IgE against Aspergillus is more than 0.37, and X-ray and eosinophilia. You can reasonably make a diagnosis of ABPA, which is relatively more common in Indian subcontinent.
So ball-like lesions in lung, whether unilateral or bilateral, indicates aspergillosis only or any other disease? How will you differentiate?
Ball-like means you will think of one is, if it is a cystic lesion, you'll think of, you will not think of ABPA, but you'll think of some cystic lesion. It may be more likely to be a hydrated cyst, it may be bronchogenic cyst, or it may be other cystic lesion. But if you are finding something like a crescent, there is a already pre-existing cavity and there is a ball-like lesion, which is mobile, then it is more likely to be a Aspergillus or some other tropical, though less common, other tropical fungi. And if it is an immunocompromised host, there is a nodularity in the chest, and then you do a CT scan of the chest and you find there is a crescent, it is more likely to be invasive Aspergillus, which is different from a allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis.
Sir, in terms of CT or bronchoscopy with ball, could you highlight the pointers which guide one over another? Also, please explain the reason of the particular CT finding of bronchiolitis obliterans.
Yeah, as I said, bronchiolitis obliterans is
lower airway.
I show the CT scan here. Say you can see the CT scan. There is some area which are hyperinflated, some area which are whitish. So it is suggested that this is a, say, bronchioles which get inflamed. And then some gets atelectasis, some gets hyperinflated, ball wall type or other type of obstruction. And that is responsible for this type of CT scan. Does this answer?
Okay. Yeah, sir. The other part of the question is, sir, in terms of CT or bronchoscopy with ball, could you highlight the pointers which guide one over another?
These are sometimes complementary to each other, but most of the time, say, if you have an easy accessibility of CT scan, you will go for, after X-ray, you will go for a CT scan, you may be able to identify some lymph node, some consolidation, infiltrates, or some malformations. So, for if you are considering it to be an extra airway malformation, CT scan is the best. Because bronchoscopy will be able to tell you about the airways, not about the bronchogenic cyst or other cyst or some other lesion. While if there is a, some strider, say trichomalacia, bronchomalacia in a small infant, in those situations, CT will not be able to tell you unless you have an accessibility of dynamic CT in which there is a more of a this radiation. So that's why in those situations, you will go for bronchoscopy. But if you are considering it to be a solid lesion, consolidation, or some cystic lesion malformation, you will go for a CT scan. If there is a persistent consolidation, in that situation, bronchoscopy may help you in taking a bronchiolar lavage and identification of the pathogenic organism.
Okay, sir. Next question is, according to the TB guidelines, the symptoms are usually a persistent one. Should we rule out TB in all cases of recurrent LRI?
No, as I said, if it is recurrent, it means it is improving and then again having the problem. Then think of beyond tuberculosis. It is unlikely to be TB. Think of if it is recurring again and again, sometimes responding to amoxiclav, sometimes responding to ceftriaxone, then it is not tuberculosis. So we should be very careful in investigating a child for TB if it is a recurrent. Because the first thing there, the entry of our TB algorithm is that it should be unremitting cough for more than 2 weeks. So that takes out all those other conditions. Because in asthma, upper respiratory infection, persistent reactive airway disease, all these will be waxing and waning. So that's why it is very important that we should be carefully screening these patients by history.
Sir, another question is, what is the role of viral panel in poorly responding IPD patch admitted with bronchopneumonia?
Bronchopneumonia, as I said that few years ago, we were not having access to the viral infection viral panels. And then now we are getting a viral panel as well as RT-PCR for pneumococcus, haemophilus influenzae, streptococcus, all those things. And that has created more confusion rather than helping us in the clinical management, because we do not know how to interpret the results. So as far as if there is a consolidation, then it is less likely to be a viral infection. But if there is something like this, here you are seeing that there is a bronchiolitis obliterans, or there is a say persistent infection with reticulonodular shadows, then you will think of viral infection and you can investigate them. Now the question comes whether I should send a viral panel in the beginning itself when I see the child first time. Possibly as of now, it is very difficult to interpret, but if it is a typical RSV in the bronchiolitis and you send it and you find that it is RSV or adenovirus, it's fine. It is not helping you in or changing the intervention. And as of now, in our country, almost 10 to 40% of children who have a viral infection may have a mixed infection of bacteria, virus, or mycoplasma. So that is also not helping you, that I'll withhold the antibiotics. So as of now, I would say that get a viral panel in selected cases where there is a very high likelihood of complicated viral pneumonia like bronchiolitis obliterans or some other problem. In that case, you are justified in going for a viral panel. But in routine community acquired pneumonia with some patch of consolidation, it's not indicated.
Sir, how long to give itraconazole in ABPA?
It is generally for 6 months. Say for ABPA, you start with prednisolone, 1 to 2 milligram per kilo for 2 weeks. Along with that, some units give itraconazole, some unit only give prednisolone. In our unit, we give both for 6 months together. So steroids, sir, are tapered after 2 weeks, but we continue alternate day for 6 months, but itraconazole for 6 months daily.
Okay, sir. The next question is, how can a pediatrician without access to sweat chloride test and mutation analysis make a diagnosis of cystic fibrosis? Are we supposed to treat the patient as CF in such cases?
Yeah. If you see some of our publications, we suggested a clinical algorithm when to suspect. If a child is having a recurrent respiratory tract infection with some malabsorption, with failure to thrive, then what we do is we look for serum electrolytes, ABG, stool for fat globules, and sputum, if possible, for culture. If you identify say hypochloremic, hyponatremic, metabolic alkalosis, several more than 10 fat globules in stool, or you find something in the pseudomonas in sputum, then you are justified in saying that it is a suspected or probable cystic fibrosis, and you are justified in starting the treatment. Now our group is working on another screening test that is called aquagenic wrinkling. I have not included it because it is mainly for the repeated respiratory infection. So aquagenic wrinkling is a simple, inexpensive test which can be carried out anywhere in the world. Say, what you do is you take up water in a vessel, you put the child's hand in it for 3 minutes, take it out and see whether there are wrinkles. So it may be able to identify almost 80 children out of 100 who are probable cystic fibrosis, but its specificity is low, suggesting that it may be present even in the other children also. So that is also another screening test. If you do not have access to sweat chloride, go for aquagenic wrinkling. If some, all of us will have aquagenic wrinkling after 10-15 minutes if we put our hand in the water. But if it happens before 3 minutes, it suggests that it is probably increased and it may be cystic fibrosis.
Sir, is immunoreactive trypsin is helpful in diagnosis of CF?
Immunoreactive trypsinogen is available is for a cold blood test for the neonatal test for a neonatal screening, not cold blood. And principle is same. Like in cystic fibrosis, thick viscid secretions block the pancreatic ducts. There is a leakage of trypsinogen in the blood. And in first few weeks, 1 to 2 weeks, it may be identified on a immunoreactive trypsinogen test. It has a significant false positive. So it cannot be used for diagnosis. It can be used for screening. Then you do a sweat test. Then you do a sweat testing or these mutation testing. Nowadays, people are doing mutation testing at various places. They transport the sample and then they do this test.
The next question you already answered, sir, even though I'm reading that question. How good is aquagenic Ringlin test to diagnose cystic fibrosis in a resource-limited setting?
It is very simple. You take any bowel in your clinic, clean the hand of the child, put one hand in it. After 3 minutes, take it out, compare it with the other hand. And if you find that one hand is showing more wrinkling as compared to the normal control, it suggests that there is an increased wrinkling. And if there is a clinical features, then you can say that it is a probable CF.
Sir, serum galactomin in ABPA.
As I said, ABPA is allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. So it is an allergic reaction rather than an invasive fungal infection. So occasionally you may find positive more than 0.6 or 0.5, but otherwise it will be negative. Once you find, you are thinking of an invasive fungal infection of the lungs. In that case, you will find that it will be a positive. Invasive fungal infection, you use galactomannan, but for ABPA, you do a IgE and specific IgE or skin prick test.
Sir, if there is a bronchopulmonary pneumonia in a toddler age group, is role of chloramphenicol still exist?
Yeah, I am not able to follow this. Can you repeat it?
Role of chloramphenicol
in a child with bronchopneumonia, the role of chloramphenicol.
Chloramphenicol now. Is it given now?
Yeah. It is given up earlier, as sir directly said, that earlier it was part of the ARI control program, that all severe pneumonia, very severe pneumonia admitted in hospitals should get a crystalline penicillin and chloramphenicol. So now it has been given up, and now there is no role of chloramphenicol, which should not be using unless specifically some organism is resistant to all other antibiotics.
Sir, significance of stool elastase in CF.
Yeah. Fecal elastase indicates that it is a pancreatic origin steatorrhea. Pancreatic insufficiency. So it is important to know that if there is a pancreatic origin steatorrhea in a child below 20 years of age, think of CF as the leading cause. So it can be used for assessing whether there is a pancreatic insufficiency and indirectly suggesting that it is, and the commonest cause would be cystic fibrosis. But it is not specific for cystic fibrosis. But other important finding here is that sometimes what happens is that you have started the child on pancreatic enzyme supplement, and then your other test will not be helpful, like stool fecal fat and other thing. In that case, this is not affected by the pancreatic enzyme. So even if a child is on pancreatic enzyme, you can test it for pancreatic insufficiency. And if you are suspecting it is a CF, you are able to identify that fecal elastase is absent. In that case, it is more or less clear that we are having a CA.
Sir, your comment about the Loflare's pneumonia, Loflare's syndrome, is it common?
Yeah, it happens in certain area, but most of the time Loflare's syndrome is because of the ankylostoma or roundworm infestation when their larvae are migrating from the lungs. And there will be fleeting shadows. It is self-limiting. Many a time we may be missing it. And we treat them with antibiotics or bleaching, we give them steroids, and then they recover. So it is it is not uncommon, I would say, and it is probably missed.
Thank you, sir. That is the last question in the chat box. Over to Sukumaran, sir.
Yes, see. Thank you, Dr. Kabra, for an excellent talk with excellent cases. Thank you very much. To conclude this session, I just want to highlight a few points. When you see a child with a recurrent respiratory infection, most important thing is that you must try to find out whether it is a recurrent viral infection, it's a benign condition, or the child is having a serious underlying organic lung disease. If a child is having a failure to thrive, clubbing, cyanosis, persistent lung infiltrate, definitely you must look for an organic problem, and these children should be investigated. Dr. Kabra was again highlighting about this PAR, serious, persistent, unusual, recurrent infections in children with immunodeficiency. And also, one clue for immunodeficiency as a general pediatrician, you must look for a BCG scar. If BCG has not taken up, it may be a problem with the cell-mediated immunity. Look at the throat for any tonsils. If the tonsils and adenoids are absent, the child may be having a gamma globulinemia. Another problem that is very commonly seen in children nowadays is what is called a persistent bacterial bronchitis. We can present with the recurrent respiratory infection. So once again, thank you very much for the excellent presentation. Thank you all for your patient hearing. And thank you once again for giving this opportunity to chair this session. Thank you, Ashok. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
I enjoyed very much interacting with all of you. And as I said, this will be probably a new normal. We may be meeting more frequently like this. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, Kabra, sir, for that excellent presentation.
Wonderful.
Touching all the aspects of the recurrent respiratory tract infection, starting from the common condition like congenital lobar emphysema to rare conditions. With this, we are, CK sir is?
Yes, we are Petsonians.
Yeah.
Recently, we formed a group, and he is a very active member of Petsonians. That's a complete talk I heard. Thank you very much. One question I want to put across to you. Once Bal, are you doing the cytology of this material that is available for you? Because this is something which people are looking for classifying the type of asthma. Are you doing it in institute?
Can you repeat?
Bronchoalveolar lavage.
We do bronchial lavage routinely. We perform almost 8 to 10 bronchoscopies per week.
Right.
We do for asthma, we are not doing it routinely, but those who are not responding to our treatment, then we go for a bronchial lavage to see what is the type of inflammation. And then we decide about the treatment, whether it is a eosinophilic, neutrophilic, or some other.
Yes, exactly.
Sometimes we do a bronchoscopy if it is an asthma mimicker to rule out other conditions.
Right, right.
So I may be having some webinar by Indian Academy of Pediatrics on asthma treatment, all these AVPA and these type of cells and inflammation. I'll be covering tomorrow.
Okay.
IAP webinar.
Okay.
Yes, that is very good, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Parvati madam. Parvati madam. Whether you want to make a comment.
Yes.
Madam, please.
It was an excellent talk. Very nice. We can hear from Delhi. That's excellent. Because of Zoom meeting without going there. Okay. Nice.
But we all know. Kabra sir had a very, very good role in making the pediatric guideline 2020 update. I also attended that training, POT, at Bombay in 2019. And his class was really great. Within 8 hours, the entire topics was covered with good information. Thank you, sir, for that excellent session. As the time is already 9:15, we are going to wind up. Over to Dr. Nihas for a lot of thanks. Thank you very much, Sumara sir, for chairing the session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Kabra sir, for coming to IAP Calicut and delivering such a nice and excellent session for us, going through all the aspects of recurrent respiratory tract infection. Thank you, sir, for that excellent session. Thank you, Sumara sir, for chairing this session and giving apt inputs about acute respiratory tract infection. You are always close to us. Thank you, sir, for being here. And thank you, Narayan sir and Bala sir, the state office bearers who are supporting us for all our programs. And I also like to thank Dr. Anandakeshavan sir and Ramesh sir for coming on all our sessions and being there for us for all the sessions. And I also thank all our seniors, CK sir, Shaji sir, Priya sir, and all others who joined us today, and all my teachers, my friends and colleagues who joined us. Thank Ranjit for hosting this meeting, and I thank our team, Vijay Kumar sir, Ashraf sir, Krishna Mohan, Ranjit, and all others who helped us for getting through this Meet the Doyens series. Thank you. Good night. We'll be having the next session of Doyens on Monday. Thank you.
Tomorrow, we will have a state-level inauguration of the breastfeeding week, Nihas.
Yeah.
Please announce that also.
Yeah, we have state-level inauguration of the breastfeeding week. It is done by our Honorable Minister, Srimati Shaili teacher. So I invite all of you to be a part of it. The meeting starts at 8:15 p.m. So I request all of you to attend that meeting also. We'll have a small session following that inauguration tomorrow about breastfeeding, taken by Dr. Mohandas Nair. Thank you all.
Thank you. Good night.